of the Foundation for Integrated Medicine, a nonprofit educational organization committed to integrating nutritional therapies into clinical practice. He is a board-certified internist and a fellow of the American College of Physicians and the American College of Nutrition. Dr. Gallen received his education at Harvard University and the New York University School of Medicine and trained in internal medicine at the New York University Bellevue Medical Center. He has held faculty positions at New York University, Rockefeller Center, the State University of New York, and the University of Connecticut. Interviews with Dr. Gallen and articles about his work have appeared in Newsweek, the New York Times, the Washington Post, Reader's Digest, Self, Bazaar, and Men's Fitness. He has appeared as a medical expert on The Good Morning Show, Today Show, PBS, CNN, and MSNBC. Please give him a round of applause.
It's not clear whether the hypomagnesemia is the cause of this increased risk of complications or a reflection of the severity of the illness. Numerous small clinical trials have shown that magnesium supplementation may slightly reduce blood pressure, increase insulin sensitivity, and retard the development of neuropathy. The doses used are in the range of 300 to 400 milligrams per day. Thiamine is the vitamin that is the most studied in alcoholism. Alcoholism may produce a vitamin B1 or thiamine deficiency and neuropathy. I haven't seen any data indicating that thiamine is deficient in diabetics, but there have been studies done looking at high-dose thiamine supplementation in diabetes. One study which involved the use of benfotiamine, a lipid-soluble form of thiamine, found that it improved painful diabetic neuropathy at a dose of 320 milligrams per day. Another study using thiamine hypochlorite, water-soluble, 300 milligrams per day, showed a decrease in the progression of diabetic neuropathy compared to placebo. If thiamine is beneficial with regard to the complications of diabetes, then it is possible that thiamine deficiency may aggravate the appearance of those complications. Homocysteine is a molecule that has been studied extensively over the past 15 years, and both alcoholism and diabetes elevate homocysteine. Homocysteine is an amino acid produced by the demethylation of methionine. It is toxic to the vascular system. And there are many causes of elevated homocysteine in diabetics and alcoholics. One cause would be deficiencies of folate, vitamin B12, and vitamin B6. Renal disease is another cause of homocysteine elevation, probably because renal homocysteine excretion isn't there. The third mechanism is the hyperexcretion of betaine or trimethylglycine, which may occur in diabetes. Either depends on methylfolate or trimethylglycine, and depletion of either may elevate homocysteine levels. Now, there have been a number of studies that have looked at whether reducing homocysteine with B vitamins, folic acid in particular, often combined with vitamin B12 and vitamin B6, have cardiovascular benefits. No clinical trial has shown any cardiovascular benefits for high-dose folate for homocysteine reduction, or renal benefits either. That doesn't mean that there's no benefit, and there has been one study which showed improvement in cognitive function in people with mild Alzheimer's disease who had elevated homocysteine, and another study showing an improvement in macular degeneration or prevention of macular degeneration in menopausal women. Nonetheless, in the diabetic population, high-dose folic acid does not appear to be helpful. There was one study which showed increased progression of diabetic nephropathy in patients given high-dose folate for homocysteine reduction. And in patients with acute coronary syndromes or who have already suffered a myocardial infarction, several studies have shown an increase in negative events. This method is not recommended. There are alternatives to high-dose B vitamins for reducing homocysteine. None of these have been studied in clinical trials. The homocysteine-lowering effects has been studied, but clinical outcomes have not been. And these include fish oils, trimethylglycine as a supplement, and N-acetylcysteine, an amino acid. And I'll be saying a little bit more about N-acetylcysteine shortly. N-acetylcysteine is in the category of antioxidants, and there have been several studies that have looked at a role, possible role for so-called antioxidant supplementation in alcoholics and diabetics. Now, the term antioxidant, I think, can be misleading. It's a relative term. Substances may be antioxidant in one context and pro-oxidant in another. And some of the substances that are called antioxidant may owe their physiological effects to effects that are not dependent upon redox status. So vitamin E supplementation in diabetics has been shown to improve beta cell function at doses 400 to 800 IUs a day, D-alpha tocopherol. Improved endothelial function has been demonstrated. There's no data on improved clinical outcomes. There is one study that was done in non-alcoholic fatty liver disease in patients with metabolic syndrome that found that 1,000 milligrams per day, there was an improvement in liver steatosis. This was not seen with metformin. Vitamin E, however, can have complex effects, and I think some of these are responsible for the negative results in some of the clinical trials. On the positive end, aside from its antioxidant effects, it increases intracellular magnesium levels, and some researchers have speculated that the benefits of vitamin E are related to the improvement in intracellular magnesium in diabetics. However, alpha tocopherol may deplete coenzyme Q10, specifically ubiquinol, which is the reduced form of coenzyme Q10, because high doses of vitamin E are oxidized to quinones, to alpha tocopherol quinones, and then get recycled back to alpha tocopherol. That recycling of the oxidized vitamin E to the reduced form of vitamin E oxidizes coenzyme Q10. It's been my theory that some of the adverse effects of vitamin E supplementation, especially in patients with heart failure, where there's an increase in mortality with high dose vitamin E, may be related to this depleting effect on coenzyme Q10. Vitamin E also depletes gamma tocopherol, which is another form of the vitamin E complex, and those are undesirable effects. Studies done in patients taking statins have shown a negative interaction between statins and alpha tocopherol. First of all, statins interfere with the antioxidant effects of alpha tocopherol. And secondly, alpha tocopherol may interfere with some of the benefits of statins. And this negative effect was described in patients who did not have elevated lipids but had low HDL cholesterol and were taking statins with the goal of raising HDL cholesterol and improving clinical events. The increase in HDL-C was blocked and the clinical outcomes were impaired in patients on statins with alpha tocopherol at a dose of 400 units a day. So this is a very complex supplement to use. N-acetylcysteine has been used in many, many clinical trials and physiological experiments and has been shown repeatedly to improve vascular endothelial function, to enhance the activity of several different types of drugs in different clinical situations. ACE inhibitors in hypertensive patients may have their activity enhanced by acetylcysteine. Nitrates have their activity enhanced and also their side effects. N-acetylcysteine reduces the level of homocysteine by displacing homocysteine from protein binding. It also is useful in supporting hepatic phase 2 detoxification and enhancing the synthesis of glutathione. Now, there are very few studies that have actually looked at this in terms of clinical outcomes. These are physiological effects. In alcoholics, there's evidence that N-acetylcysteine can decrease acetaminophen toxicity. In fact, NAC is the treatment of choice for acetaminophen overdose. There's one study in patients with non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, which found that N-acetylcysteine at a dose of 1200 milligrams per day plus L-arginine at a dose of 1200 milligrams per day reduced endothelial cell activation and systolic blood pressure. Other clinical endpoints weren't studied. Pycnogenol is an antioxidant flavonoid complex from the bark of the French maritime pine. There are five controlled clinical trials using pycnogenol in type 2 diabetes. All were funded by the patent holder on pycnogenol, but they were all done at academic institutions. And in these studies, pycnogenol at a dose of 100 milligrams per day was found to reduce glucose levels, improve endothelial function, and to improve vision and retard the progression of diabetic retinopathy. In diabetics and alcoholics, the concept of conditionally essential nutrients may apply. A conditionally essential nutrient is a nutrient that is required under certain physiologic or pathologic conditions because, although ordinarily manufactured in the body, the body's ability to make this substance is limited, rendering deficiency states possible. Cysteine, which is the non-esterified amino acid of N-acetylcysteine, is one, and there are some studies suggesting that cysteine may be a conditional amino acid, especially in alcoholics, because of depletion of glutathione in alcoholics because of the combination of diet and alcohol. Arginine, which was just mentioned as being helpful in type 2 diabetes for reducing blood pressure when combined with N-acetylcysteine, has also been characterized as a conditionally essential nutrient, sometimes in diabetics or alcoholics. Carnitine and its esters carnitine has been characterized as a conditionally essential nutrient in a number of different situations. And gamma-linolenic acid, which is an omega-6 fatty acid,